For this morning, we're going to go back to something old, and that's John 6. We have been sort of milling around in John 6 now for 5 weeks, and what a tremendous blessing. This is not an easy chapter to pull together, 71 verses to start with, even with, let's say we do 6 messages on this. For me, covering 71 verses in 6 messages is a minor achievement because there's so much here. But I've tried to tell you that this chapter, the 6th chapter of John, really one of the great chapters in all of Holy Scripture, while it has diverse components, and in most cases it's treated that way, people who comment on this or preach on this chapter sort of break it up into pieces and maybe miss the whole purpose of the chapter. Those who established many, many years ago where the chapter breaks should go really had a relatively easy time doing that. In this case, because it begins with, after these things, Jesus went away. And then it ends in chapter 7, verse 1, after these things, Jesus was walking in Galilee. So this is clearly an isolated series in this 6th chapter, Divine Revelation from the Holy Spirit. And it incorporates things that happened over a couple of days at the very end of our Lord's Galilean ministry. His ministry in Galilee lasted over a year. This is the kind of the wrap-up on it. And so what we get is kind of a finality to this whole thing. And you don't really understand where the chapter's going till you come to the end of the chapter. That's what I've been telling you. So look at verse 66, very near the end. As a result of this referring back to what had been said and done through that chapter. As a result of this, many of his disciples withdrew from him, from association with him, and were not walking with him anymore. And there's finality there. They made the final decision to walk away from Christ. This chapter then is the story of the disciples who were following Jesus who abandoned him. Keep in mind, this is at the end of a lengthy ministry in Galilee in which he has done miracles on a daily basis and in which he has taught the principles concerning the kingdom of heaven, which he has vindicated all his claims by his work and his words, and their final decision is to walk away, and it's not a few, it's the many. In fact, in contrast to them, verse 67, Jesus said to the 12, "You do not want to go away also, do you?" Did it come down to the fact that they all left except the 12 and there were thousands upon thousands upon thousands of them? Well, maybe not. Maybe there were some others left. But the best that can be said is after the resurrection when Jesus appeared in Galilee, there were only 500 who had gathered together to see him after his resurrection. So the thousands and thousands that followed him seems to be diminished here significantly. And even after his resurrection, 500 eyewitnesses to his appearance there is all there were among the tens of thousands in Galilee. It's a story then of defection. It's a story of false discipleship. It's a chapter about that. It all starts out with a flurry in the miracle of feeding the 5,000 men plus women and children, which puts you between 20 and 25,000 people. The Lord creates food. The same day that he created the food, he was healing and casting out demons, and it was just another day like any other day of miracles for him, but featured that amazing healing miracle. Subsequent to that, in verses 16 to 21, is the story of him walking on water. And of course, John includes those two miracles because it fits his purpose. The miracles prove that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Now, John uses that as evidence for his deity and his claims. Starting after the two miracles, we begin to hear Jesus teach, and he teaches for virtually the rest of the chapter from, say, verse 26 to verse 59. It's his word. So it starts out with his works and then moves to his words, and that fits John's purpose. John is concerned to be able to show the reader that either the works or the words of Jesus give ample evidence to confirm that his claim to be God, Messiah, the Savior, is a legitimate claim. Believe me, Jesus says, for my words, believe me for my works. So John, true to his mission, true to his statement of purpose in John 20, 31, is writing these things about his works, these things about his words, that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life in his name. So it's an evangelistic purpose. But in this chapter, the hope that you might have that the works of Jesus and the words of Jesus would convince all the people who were following him and seeing his miracles and hearing his words dies. Because you come to verse 66, and many of those who were his students, that's what disciple means, mathetes, learner, student, many of his students who had followed him for some period of time abandon him with finality. They leave. In that sense, it's a sad chapter, very sad, and it's very sad for Christ, and we'll see that today and then one final message next week. But our Lord gives us in this chapter a glimpse of the characteristics of false disciples. Who is likely to defect? Who is likely to walk away? Hebrews chapters 2, 3, 4, 6, 10 warn about hearing the truth, knowing the truth, and walking away from the truth and the more severe punishment that comes to people who do that. 1 John 2 says, they went out from us, they were not of us. Jesus warned that there would be soil that would receive the word and then it would die, wither and die, temporary converts. That's a big part of biblical teaching. But here, more than any other chapter, you see something of sort of the internal pathology of false discipleship. What motivates these false disciples, these defectors, who even though they've seen miracles, not just one, but many, and even though they've heard Jesus not just once, but many times, decide to walk away from him. This chapter gives us a glimpse into what is going on in their minds and in their hearts. I guess we could pose the question, what were the defects in the minds of the defectors? What are the marks of false temporary disciples? How can we understand them? We have endeavored to answer these questions now, as I said, for weeks. We even included this chapter, didn't we, on Christmas Sunday, right there in John 6, because that was a perfect chapter to celebrate the incarnation as well. So we've been looking at this. I'm going to give you a very brief review, and we've put together the marks, the characteristic attitudes that dominate false disciples. One, we saw at the very beginning of the chapter, they are attracted by the crowd. They are attracted by the crowd. The bigger the crowd, the more interest they have. They are looking for the excitement. Secondly, they are fascinated by the promise of the supernatural. They are fascinated by the promise of the supernatural. These crowds were massive because supernatural things were promised and supernatural things actually were happening, and they wanted to get in on that. That still marks false disciples. They're drawn by crowds and fascinated by the promise of the supernatural. Thirdly, we saw that they are interested only in earthly benefits. They tried to take Jesus, remember, by force and make him a king so he would be able to do for them every day what he had done for them in creating a meal and in providing healings for them. They had no interest particularly in him, but they did have an interest in what he could provide, and they wanted to force him to become their king. That's how it is with false disciples. They are concerned only with earthly benefits. Fourth, we saw false disciples are indifferent to worship. They are indifferent to worship. We saw that in the little encounter where Jesus walks on the water. We compared that with Matthew 14, 33, where Matthew records the same event, and he says, when Jesus got to the boat after walking on the water, they said, the disciples, that you are the Son of God, and they worshiped him. They worshiped him. That's true of true disciples. True disciples are true worshipers. False disciples are indifferent to worship. They might come to what is called worship in a contemporary sense. There is this kind of music environment that is created today that is called worship. They may like the music and the experience. They have no interest really in directing praise and adoration toward God. And then we saw number five, that false disciples seek personal prosperity. In verses 22 to 27, they indicate their interest in earthly bread, in earthly things. And Jesus rebukes them in verse 26. You're here not because you saw the miracles, signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food which perishes. They were preoccupied with their personal prosperity, very much like seeking earthly benefits. Only this becomes very specific and very personal. And Jesus says, stop working so hard for the food that perishes, chasing me all over the north end of the Sea of Galilee to get another meal. And rather, labor for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on Him the Father, God has set His seal. So number five was seeking personal prosperity. And then last time, before Christmas, we looked at the sixth point, false disciples make demands on God. They see God as a bank. They see God as a repository for all that they want, and all they want to know is the mechanism to get it from Him. What is the way to do that? Today, they're being told positive confession will do that. If you believe it, if you speak it, if you say it, you literally create it, you make it happen, you put it into existence, you make it work. False disciples have always put demands on God. We saw that in verses 28 to 33. First, they say, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? Remember that? They want the power. Okay, how can we do what you do? The works of God, we know you do the works of God. No man can do what you do unless God is with him. That's what Nicodemus said. So we know you have divine power. How do we get that power? Give us the power. Jesus said, I'm not going to give you that. The only power you will ever be able to exercise, the only work of God that you will ever be able to do is to believe, verse 29, to believe in Him whom He has sent. Nothing more than that. He will not delegate His power to them. It was delegated, you remember, only to the apostles and the 70 temporarily, but not to the crowds, not to the masses. So they weren't going to get His power to be able to create food, to make a world that they wanted to live in. So they said, okay, if you're not going to give us the power, verse 30, then what are you going to do for a sign? If you're not going to give us the power to do it ourselves, then it's up to you to do another miracle. You've got to keep the miracles coming. If you want us to believe in you, you either give us the power or you give us the provision. You either give us what we need to do the miracles or you keep doing the miracles that satisfy our desires. So here we see false followers, the shallow, the curious, the selfish, who continue to tell the Lord what they want. They continue to make demands on Him. He needs to display miracle power on their behalf to provide what they want if He expects them to believe in Him. Give us what we want and we'll believe in you. These are seekers of personal satisfaction demanding the Lord respond to them. This is the very opposite of a true disciple. False disciples think God exists to do what they want for them. True disciples understand that the opposite is true. True disciples understand that they have confessed Jesus as Lord, and therefore no longer will they ever say, this is what I want, I expect you to deliver it. Let me say it another way. When a true believer confesses Jesus as Lord, as an act of the will, as an act of your will, when you confess Jesus as Lord in saving faith, that was the last selfish act of your will. That was the last. And at the same time, it was the first act of recognition of divine dominion. When you confess Jesus as Lord, you gave up your sovereignty. That was the last act of your will alone. And even that was not alone. But from your perception, when you embrace Jesus as Lord, you declare His sovereignty, and that becomes the first act of your recognition of His dominion. Never again in the life of a true disciple is it about what you want. It's always about what He wants. So, false disciples have a completely selfish, personal preoccupation that causes them to view God as a dispenser of the things they want. And all they're looking for is mechanisms to get those things. That's why the name it and claim it, prosperity gospel, positive confession, faith movement is so ludicrous. And it simply accumulates false disciples. Then number seven, and this is where we are today. Number seven, false disciples do not find their desires fulfilled in Christ. They do not find their desires fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Back in verse 27, the Lord said, "Stop working for the food that perishes. Stop with the temporal, earthly desires. And begin to work, labor, for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you." Which the Son of Man will give to you. Our Lord called them to turn from the food that perishes to the true food that satisfies forever. What is that food? Well, He says He'll give it. He will give it. He says, "I will give it to you. The Son of Man will give it to you." Go down to verse 35. We'll find out what it is. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life." He will give Himself. He will give Himself. And then that even becomes more explicit when He says later in the chapter, "You must eat My flesh and drink My blood." And He says it over and over again. In verse 58, "This is the bread which came down out of heaven." He will give the soul-satisfying bread. He is the soul-satisfying bread. I can't say it more simply than to say this: for the true disciple, Christ is everything. For the true disciple, Christ is everything, everything. It is never what He can give that the true disciple seeks. It is who He is that the true disciple seeks. He is the sole satisfaction of the true disciple. Paul's cry is that I may know Him, that I may know Him. Paul says everything else was manure when I met Christ. Christ was everything. I considered everything I'd ever achieved, earned, gained, acquired, trash, garbage, when I found Christ. For to me to live is Christ, die is gain. Philippians 1, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. The true disciple is completely consumed with Christ. The true disciple would say with the Apostle Paul, and I think you would understand this, the true disciple would say, "I know how to be abased, I know how to abound. I know how to have little, I know how to have much. It's all irrelevant. I don't care if I have a car or a house, I don't care if I have health or I don't have health, all I want is Christ. Christ is all there is, Christ is all I need, Christ is all I want." That's the preoccupation of a true disciple. You see that if you go with me back to Matthew 13, Matthew chapter 13. That is a great chapter on the parables of the kingdom that our Lord gave. In Matthew chapter 13, I'll remind you of what is no doubt a familiar little section, verses 44 to 46. Two very brief parables. It's unusual to get two parables in three verses, but that's what's here. "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and hid again. And from joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking fine pearls. And upon finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it." Very simple little stories. A man finds a treasure when he's plowing a field. He could have just grabbed the treasure and ran, but he's an honorable man. So he put it back, and according to Jewish law, if he was to be entitled to that treasure, he had to buy the entire field, which he did. And so he had to sell everything he had to purchase the field to get the treasure. He came across it somewhat inadvertently. In the second story, this is a merchant looking for pearls. This is a man on a mission, and he finds one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. So here's the key. Finding a treasure, whether you stumbled across it or whether you were in a search for it, that is so valuable you literally sell everything for this one treasure. This one treasure. It was common in ancient days to bury treasures in fields. There weren't banks as such that were safe, and so you buried it in a case in a field, and it could come up maybe generations later, years later, when different owners owned the field. That was not uncommon. And pearls were believed to be the most valuable of all things in terms of jewelry. Here is then something very familiar to those folks. The interpretation somehow gets confused through the years in the church for reasons that I don't know. It's pretty simple. What is the treasure and what is the pearl? whatever it is, it's the most valuable thing possible. It's the most valuable thing there is, so valuable that literally you'd give up everything to purchase it, absolutely everything you possess. The answer is the treasure is Christ, the pearl is Christ. You buy Christ. You sell all to buy Christ. Riches beyond comprehension, incorruptible, undefiled, unfading, infinite, eternal riches in Christ. It's all about Him. In Him are all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. In Him we find redemption and wisdom and righteousness, 1 Corinthians 1:30. Christ is all in all. In Him we are blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenlies. Christ is everything. False disciples don't see this. That's why Christ is not the feature of the preachers. He's not the message. He's not the attraction. He's not what is sold. Because false disciples don't look at the glories of Christ and find in Him all they ever want. But true disciples do. The soul, S-O-L-E, the soul satisfaction of a true disciple is Christ and Christ alone. Everything he wants is in Christ and Christ alone. And to be Christ's and to belong to Christ and to be owned by Christ and cared for by Him and blessed by Him and promised future glory by Him and kept by Him is sheer joy and exhilaration to the true disciple. Out of sheer joy in the hope of forgiveness, salvation, holiness, righteousness, heaven, the true eternal riches, the true disciple looks at everything he has in this world and considers it manure compared to Christ. The false disciple, he wants more of what he's already got from Christ. He wants more money, more stuff, more success, more worldly trash, more what Paul calls dung. The true disciple, all he wants is Christ. Christ is all in all. I love that little song, and I hear it all the time. Fernando Ortega sings, "Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Just give me Jesus. In my life, in my death, give me Jesus." That's all his soul wants. That's all the true disciple wants. It's not about heritage. It's not about achievement. It's not about money. It's not about acquisitions. It's about Jesus. But that's not the case with false disciples. Yes, eternal life is a free gift. Yes, already purchased by Jesus Christ. But paradoxically, it's costly. You sell everything. Why? Because Christ is singularly precious. Give me Christ, although you take everything else away. Rich young ruler, that was not a deal he was willing to make. He was rich. He wanted to hang on to his money. He wanted Jesus if Jesus gave him more of what he already loved. You see, the true disciple is saying, I will forsake everything. The true disciple denies himself, takes up his cross, even facing death, and follows Christ. The true disciple will hate his father, his mother, his sister, his brother, yes, and even his whole life, his own life. The true disciple will count the cost, and no matter what the cost, Jesus is worth the price. I know wise investors don't put all their money into one single investment, but that's exactly what a true believer does. You can spot a false disciple by the preoccupation of that disciple with what Jesus gives. You can spot a true disciple by the preoccupation of that true disciple with who Jesus is. Well, go to verse 36 of John 6. This group that day weren't interested in Jesus, and that's the point. They have no real interest in Jesus himself. So verse 36, I said to you that you've seen me. Give a full disclosure. You've seen me with your own eyes, not like faith. This is sight. You saw. You've seen the miracles. You've participated in them. You've heard me, and you do not believe. This is the hardness of the human heart. They saw it all, heard it all. They have no interest in Him. They don't want Him. Oh, they want what He can provide. Give us this bread daily. They want the power, and they want the provision. They don't want Him. They have no love for Him. This is a powerful blow. It would be a powerful blow to anyone. If it's not your experience, I'd be surprised that you have done your best to proclaim Christ to someone, to give them the gospel, to make it understandable, believable, and you've been scorned, and you've been repudiated, and you've been completely rejected, and somebody turns their back and walks away. Maybe you've done that with family members. Maybe you've done that with close friends, acquaintances, people at work, and you just sort of don't understand how can this happen? How after all that you have said and all that Christ means to you and all that you've conveyed, can somebody turn their back and walk away from Christ? Well, Jesus is in that very position, only exponentially so, because He has literally been in their presence doing these miracles on a daily basis for over a year. And this group still doesn't believe. And it isn't that they don't have evidence. It is that they're not interested in what He offers. Of course, the danger at this point is to change the offer, which is what contemporary evangelicalism has done, and start offering people exactly what they already want, which is a perversion. So how does Jesus handle this? Now remember, Jesus is human. He reacts, I think, like a man would react, like I would react. He reacts in a most amazing way. And you know these verses, verses 37 and following, you know them, but I wonder if you know them in this context. Starting with verse 37, there's a soliloquy here. That's a kind of a talking to yourself moment. They would have heard Him, but Jesus is speaking in a sorrowful way. It's kind of defensive, I guess you could say. These are words that are helping Jesus get His balance. If you and I expect people to respond to the gospel, what might have been His expectation as a man? Would He not have had the expectation that all that He offered would have been most glorious, most welcome? I think this is a painful moment in His life. I think this is a moment that is disappointing, heartbreaking, crushing to Him. I don't know if He wept, but He might well have. We don't have a record of that. This is a heartbreaking moment. So how does He react? Listen to how He reacts. Verse 37, "All that the Father gives me will come to me." Wow, amazing. What is He doing there? I'll tell you what He is doing. He's leaning hard on divine election. He's doing exactly what you have to do. He's doing exactly what I have to do. To explain the same exact circumstance. Why don't they believe? Why don't they listen? Why don't they come? Why don't they accept? Why don't they acknowledge? The truth is it's so wonderful. It's so evident. It's so powerful. Why don't they react? And where do you go? Eventually, you rest in the sovereign purpose of God, right? I don't want to break your world apart, but I will just tell you this. Jesus was the first Calvinist in the New Testament. He just leaned hard on divine sovereign election and divine sovereign calling, and He knew that no one could come unless the Father drew him. Oh, all the Father gives me will come to me. The one who comes to me I will certainly not cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of Him who sent me. In that sense, He's like us. We didn't come down from heaven, but His one goal in life was to do the will of the Father, and He knew the Father had a will, and that the Father's will would be fulfilled, and He rested in that. Verse 39, "This is the will of Him who sent me, that of all that He has given me, I lose none, but raise it up on the last day." He backs up into this great, massive, overwhelming doctrine of divine sovereign election in salvation. That no one is going to believe unless the Father decides he must believe. Verse 44, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him." Verse 65, "For this reason I have said to you, no one can come to me unless it's been granted him from the Father." Here is our Lord Jesus. You could safely say the disappointed evangelist, the heartbroken evangelist who has literally demonstrated his deity and the validity of his message for over a year to these people. They will not believe. Where does he go for comfort? Where does he go to find his equilibrium, to find his balance, to end his disappointment, to deal with his sorrow? He rests in the Father's will, the Father's choice, the Father's calling, the Father's instruction of the sinner's soul. And he says, "When the Father draws, when the Father gives to me, I will receive, I will keep, and I will raise him at the end." In the 10th chapter of John, there's a very similar text. In verse 26, again, he's always facing this rejection. Verse 26, "You do not believe. You do not believe because you're not of my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give eternal life to them, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand." Again, the same scenario. You don't believe. You don't believe. But then again, those who are the Father's, who are given to me, who then become my sheep, will hear, will believe, I will receive, I will keep, I will raise. This is a great statement of our Lord's confidence in divine sovereign election and calling unto salvation. And then in verse 40, the other side, "For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I will raise him on the last day." Do you see that? That is the apparent paradox. That is the two sides of the everlasting discussion about the sovereignty of God and human responsibility. Verses 37, 38, 39, the Father draws, the Father wills, it's all his plan. And then in verse 40, Jesus looks at the other side and says, "Everyone who believes, everyone who believes." There's no self-consciousness here. There's no effort to explain the mystery of this great reality. "I will raise those up whom the Father gives me. I will also raise up anyone who believes." I just want to comfort you in saying, even our Lord Jesus Christ doesn't explain to a middle ground. He doesn't look for some bridge between those two challenging realities. But the bottom line for us in this text is they didn't believe. They didn't believe. They didn't believe. This gets repeated, verse 47, "I say to you, he who believes has eternal life." He who believes has eternal life. And he says it again, repeatedly, through this entire sermon on himself as the bread of life. Whoever believes has eternal life. Whoever believes has eternal life. Whoever believes has eternal life. You don't believe, but then again, no one can believe unless the Father draws him. I can take you no other place than where our Lord is right here. And you have to find comfort in both realities and know that they're clear to God even though they may not be to you, which is a good indication that you're not God. And that's very important for you to know. So here are false disciples who do not believe. They're drawn by the crowd. They're fascinated by the supernatural. They think only of earthly things. They have no real desire for worship. They seek personal prosperity. They see God as a bank. They want to make demands on him. They have no real interest in Christ. They're not attracted to Christ. So this kind of superficiality is easily disillusioned and easily led astray and easily influenced. And so the Jews jump in. This is the Jewish leaders in the synagogue. All this is happening in synagogue in Capernaum, verse 59 says. So the Jews are grumbling. Gongguzo, it's kind of an onomatopoetic word meaning to murmur. kind of speaking privately, quietly, mumbling, murmuring, grumbling under their breath about him. And he hears the mumbling and he said, "I am the bread that came down out of heaven." He reinforces his incarnation. And they were saying, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, 'I've come down out of heaven'?" This is scorn, this is mockery, this is ridicule. They're laughing at him. Verse 43, Jesus answered and said to them, "Stop grumbling among yourselves." Stop grumbling among yourselves. Why are they grumbling? Well, he shattered their hope. What was their hope? Free food. Miracle power. Signs and wonders. Easing life. Healing the sick. Delivering the demon-possessed. Feeding the hungry. That's all they wanted. They would have made great social gospel people who just wanted to fix the world a little better on the surface. Now, I'm not against helping people. I'm not against making life better. I'm not against, you know, doctors and hospitals and medical care and prayer for sick people. I'm for all of that. But that's not the message of the gospel. That's a message everybody will accept. That's the message everyone will accept. They're going to like Christians who give money to poor people. They're going to like Christians who help the down and out. They're going to like people who do social welfare kinds of things. And that's just part of being human, and that's good, and that's right. But that's not the gospel. That's not the message that we're called to preach. That will, if that's how people view Christianity, they're going to like that kind of Christianity. But Jesus said, "I'm not interested in that. I could keep on healing you, I'm done. I could keep on feeding you, I'm done." They had no desire for repentance. They had no desire for faith. They had no need in their own minds for salvation, because they were the people of God. After all, they're sitting in the synagogue with scrolls from the Old Testament. They just wanted to dine, if you will, on the husks fit for pigs, and not the sweet bread of heaven. So they mock. So they mock. And Jesus says, "Stop mocking." And then again, this has gone from "you don't believe" to "you mock." And how does he find some comfort now? Same way. Verse 44. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I'll raise him up on the last day." And again, he rests on the Father's will, on the Father's divine electing purpose and calling. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him." He doesn't say, okay, if you're going to be like that, I'll keep healing. Okay, I'll make lunch. Now, they've gone from not believing to mocking. And these are the leaders, I acknowledge. These are the leaders, but they influence the crowd. And their influence is pretty strong, because in verse 66, many of his disciples walk away. I think part of what pushed them to that final decision was the attitude of their leaders. That shows up all through his ministry. The truth is rejected, they don't believe, and then they mock. You almost sort of have to do that. You have to do that to justify your rejection. You have to make a joke out of it if you're going to reject it. You have to heap scorn on it. You can't just say, "Well, it's a wonderful message, and Jesus is a glorious person, and he's the Son of God, and the evidence is all there. I'm just not interested in believing, but it's certainly worthy of belief, and I hope many people do." No, that's not how it goes. Once you've walked away and refused to believe, you will mock the message that you have rejected for the preservation of your own ego. Jesus doesn't argue with them. It doesn't change the message. He leans again on divine sovereignty. He finds his comfort and confidence in God's power. "Father who sent me must draw, and when the Father draws, I will raise him up on the last day." And then he basically validates this view from the Old Testament. Verse 45, it is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. So how does one come to Christ in faith? One, the Father has to will it. The Father has to draw. And listen, the Father has to teach. Did you see it there in verse 45? This is basically borrowed from Isaiah 54:13, but similar statements can be found in Jeremiah, Micah, they shall all be taught of God. You know, it's not in the sinner's power to believe. It's not in the sinner's power to come. It's not in the sinner's power to repent. And that's where Jesus establishes his confidence. No one can come unless the Father who sent me draws him. And how does that work? It's all written in the prophets. They shall all be taught of God. What is his drawing? His drawing is when God internally teaches the sinner's mind a convincing truth of the gospel. Faith can't come except by hearing, and hearing by what? The word concerning Christ. No gospel, no salvation. But it's not just the external hearing, it's the internal instruction of God. Those who come are the ones the Father wills to come. Those who come are the ones the Father draws, and those who come are the ones the Father teaches. So there's divine instruction going on in the mind and the heart that makes that heart hunger for the bread of life. It's not going to happen unless the Father is the teacher. How does the Father teach? Well, verse 46, no one has seen the Father, so you didn't have a private class. Sorry to tell you that. You didn't go to heaven and talk to him. He didn't come down and talk to you. So how are you going to be taught by the Father? Well, there's one who is from God. He has seen the Father. So if you're going to be taught by the Father, you have to be taught by the one who alone knows the Father, and that's the Father's Son. I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. How does the Father teach? Through the Son, through the gospel of the Son. Hebrews 1, God in the past spoke through the prophets. God has now spoken to us in his Son. Faith comes by hearing, Romans 10, the word concerning Christ. It's so comforting to me, and I hope it is to you, to understand that Jesus finds his confidence in the midst of a heart-wrenching, heart-breaking ministry by leaning on the absolute reality and reliability of the Father's will, the Father's call, the Father's instruction in the heart of the sinner. All that the Father draws will come, and Jesus' part is to say, I will receive, I will keep, and I will raise them all and lose none. But the point we're making here is you don't have any interest in me. What do I offer you? Salvation, security, and heaven. To receive you, to hold you, and to deliver you to the eternal kingdom. That's what Jesus offers. It's all about the world to come. Whether you have it here or don't, whether you're well-known or completely obscure, whether you realize the things you thought you wanted to accomplish in your life or none of them ever happened, whether you have a lot or nothing, whether you're well or sick, you have Christ. That's all true disciples ever want. Christ is sufficient. Christ is enough. And we'll pick it up there next time. Father, thank you again for leading us as you have this morning to the richness of this passage. And I can only pray that your Holy Spirit will make what has been said feebly here indelible somehow in the hearts of those who have heard. Thank you for the clarity of your word. The message just leaps off the page with so much lucidity. It is so alive and so bright, unmistakable, and life-transforming. Thank you for encouraging us in our worship, the beauty of music and the opportunity to express our praise in those frames and in those ways. And now, Lord, we are responsible for what we know about you from this passage, and we are responsible to proclaim to the world that everyone who believes Christ will receive, and then rest confidently in the fact that no one can unless the Father draws. So, Father, we place ourselves, as always, at your disposal to do your work. We submit ourselves to the Lordship of Christ for no other purpose than to see his will accomplished in and through us. Father, again, we thank you for the gift of Christ, and we thank you for the gift of Scripture, which reveals Christ. We would not know him were it not for the Word of God. Thank you for the story, the completeness, the richness of it all. What a treasure. We bless your name. We worship you with thanksgiving. We thank you for what you have given us in Christ. May we love him more supremely. May he be our all in all. We ask these things in his name. I have to thank you for your patience in allowing me to go through the sixth chapter of John the way I've been doing it. I know you feel you're stuck in a revolving door and somehow you can't get out the other side. And I want to let you know that my best intentions were to finish today, but that's not going to happen. So you're going to be in the revolving door for another week, at least next week, as we go through this chapter. Today would be the sixth message on John 6, and that's not too many. In fact, really, in the truest sense, it's too few, but you have nonetheless been very patient as we have worked our way around this chapter. And as I've said a couple of times to you, normally you just take a paragraph when you're doing an exposition of Scripture, and you work on that paragraph, the next one, and the next one, particularly when you're dealing in a gospel narrative because the scenes change, the events change. And that would be true here, with the exception that there's one overriding theme through this entire chapter of 71 verses that has to have our attention if we're to understand it. So we're sort of stuck making a true effort at understanding this chapter with having to put our arms around the whole thing every time we meet, even though we advance it just a little. We're trying to fulfill the intent of the author. Now, I want to read the section to you because I want you to have it in mind. It's a bit arbitrary exactly where we would start, but let's just start for this morning with verse 48. And I'm going to read down to the end, so follow along. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread which comes down out of heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread also which I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Then the Jews began to argue with one another, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who eats me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread which came down out of heaven, and as the fathers ate and died, not as the fathers ate and died, he who eats this bread will live forever." These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, "This is a difficult statement. Who can listen to it?" But Jesus, conscious that his disciples grumbled at this, said to them, "Does this cause you to stumble? What then if you see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and are life. There are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who didn't believe and who it was who would betray him. And he was saying, "For this reason I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted him from the Father." As a result of this, many of his disciples withdrew and were not walking with him anymore. So Jesus said to the 12, "You do not want to go away also, do you?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have words of eternal life. We have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God." Jesus answered them, "Did I myself not choose you, the 12, and one of you is a devil?" Now he meant Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, for he was one of the 12 and was going to betray him. Really an amazing portion of Scripture. Amazing. The end of this chapter is the culmination of everything that's been going on in this chapter. And it's about spiritual defection. It's about apostasy. It's about turning your back on Jesus and walking away. This has always been very difficult for me to understand. Even since I was a very small boy, Christ has always been the most compelling, the most wondrous person that I ever knew anything about. Christ has always been the most attractive, the most wonderful. Even from the time I was a small boy, I entertained thoughts of how I might know him more, how I might know him better. Even as a child, I read books on the deeper life to find out what the secret was of really getting to know Christ. Never in my life, even as a young person, did I entertain a single thought of abandoning Christ. Many thoughts about being less than faithful and disobedient to him, but never was there a single interest in anyone else as the hope of my salvation, as the joy of my life, as the Lord of my life. As far back as I can remember, Christ was always the most wonderful and the most attractive. But as I lived my life, this turned into a concern for me because all around me I saw people walk away from Jesus. I saw it when I was very young. I saw it as a pastor's son in church. I saw it with family, cousins. I saw it with classmates in school claiming to follow Christ and turning their back and walking away as these did in verse 66. I couldn't comprehend that. I can't remember a single compelling temptation that I ever had to battle to walk away from Christ. I was curious about how this can happen. I sought to understand that even when I was a seminary student. So when it was time for me to write my dissertation to finish my degree in seminary, I chose to write a paper on a character study of Judas Iscariot. And the reason I chose that was because I still was searching for answers. And the most inexplicable apostate that I had ever known anything about was Judas. And by the way, he is mentioned at the end of the chapter because he's the model of walking away from Jesus. There's no question, he is the worst of all apostates. There's no question that he turned away from the greatest privilege that any person would ever have, spending 3 years with Jesus. It has always been incomprehensible to me that Judas could do that, really incomprehensible to me that anyone could do that. But Judas, who saw everything and heard everything. So I chose to write a paper. I couldn't find a lot to help me. I checked various libraries, Roman Catholic libraries, liberal Protestant libraries, trying to find answers to the defection of Judas. I never really found any insights outside the Bible I ended up making my conclusions based upon what the Scripture said. But it's still, to me, beyond comprehension that Judas would not believe that he would walk away from Christ, that he would betray Him, and in a final act of horrible rejection, commit suicide. But Judas is not a solitary figure, as I've been telling you. Many of Jesus' disciples walked away from Him. That's what verse 66 says. Many of His disciples withdrew and were not walking with Him anymore. There's a finality there. They walked away right into hell. Why? What were the dynamics that caused that? Now remember, this is one chapter that covers a couple of days in the life and ministry of Jesus as He brings His Galilean ministry to an end. Just a couple of days. The chapter opens on a day when Jesus feeds, say, 20 to 25,000 people by creating food on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. It begins with a massive miracle in which these thousands of people actually participated by eating the meal. They were a part of the miracle. It also contains one of the greatest discourses that Jesus ever gave in all of recorded New Testament literature, His discourse on the bread of life. The greatest miracles in terms of volume, the greatest teaching in terms of profound insight into Him and His gospel. And you come to the end of the chapter and His disciples defect. From the standpoint of evidence, their defection is inexcusable. Inexcusable. He had been doing miracles constantly. There was no way to explain them other than that they were divine. And His words were so profound that no one had ever heard words like that before. Still, according to verse 36, He acknowledges that the very people who are experiencing the miracles and listening to Him teach do not believe. You do not believe, He says. And down in verse 64, He says it again. There are some of you who do not believe. And He even says He knows who they were. And it is those disciples who did not believe in verse 66 who withdraw and walk away. He's been in Galilee for over a year. It's a small place, very small region. He's crisscrossed the hillsides and the valleys of the Galilee area and every town and every village, and even in open space countryside, the multitudes have come to Him. He made His headquarters in Capernaum, the main city at the northern end of the Sea of Galilee. He did miracles all over Galilee, over a year, as I said. The heart and soul of His ministry was the sort of adopted hometown of Capernaum, where there were many, many miracles done. Still, there was unbelief. And by the way, according to verse 59, the very message that He gives in this chapter, He gives in the synagogue in Capernaum. So Capernaum becomes the focal point as His Galilean ministry wraps up. He's in the synagogue in Capernaum where these miracles have been being done for a long, long time. And as I said, from the evidential standpoint, there is no excuse for their unbelief. In fact, their unbelief is so inexcusable that we read some of the most frightening words in all of the New Testament with regard to them. Listen to Matthew chapter 11. Verse 20 and following, where Jesus pronounces doom on the cities of Galilee. He began to denounce the cities in which most of His miracles were done because they didn't repent. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles had occurred in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. You remember in the Old Testament history, they didn't repent and were destroyed. Nevertheless, I say to you, it'll be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And they were pagan cities. And then in verse 23, "And you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will descend to Hades. For if the miracles had occurred in Sodom, which occurred in you, it would have remained to this day. Nevertheless, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you." Sodomites who were buried under fire and brimstone will have an easier time in hell than the religious population of Capernaum because they ignored the miracles that were done there. As bad as the bizarre, corrupt, homosexual vice and lust and gross evil of Sodom and Gomorrah was, Capernaum's people were waiting for a more severe eternal hell for their unbelief. So unbelief is the end result of the Galilean ministry. The first year of his ministry in Judea was marked by unbelief and hostility, and the hostility grew so great that he had to go north. He was forced to go north and leave Judea for his own safety to complete his ministry. He went to Galilee, and while the same kind of crowds followed him as had in Judea, they were equally fickle and superficial. And here we find at the end of that Galilean ministry, they're marked by unbelief and defection. This is such a painful experience for our Lord. This is such an agonizing experience. The pain comes out in verse 67. Jesus said to the 12, "You do not want to go away also, do you?" He's fully human. He's deeply wounded, cut to the heart by the disaffection of those to whom he has given such a massive display of evidence concerning his deity and messiahship. In fact, the only way he can find any balance in this, the only way he can find any comfort, is to lean hard on the sovereignty of God, as he does in verse 37, "All that the Father gives me will come to me." As he does in verse 44, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him." As he does in verse 65, "For this reason I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted him from the Father." He rests in the fact that divine sovereignty is the final decider of whether sinners come. He rests in the Father's plan. In the face of rejection, the only comfort he can find is that the Father will draw whom the Father wills to draw. He will call whom he wills to call in the end. Now, as we come to the end of the chapter, in particular verses 60 to 71, the false disciples are exposed. There's a little sequence here that exposes them. First, they say, "This is difficult. This is difficult." Then they grumble, then they stumble, then they defect. Also at the last part, from verses 60 to the end, the true disciples are evidenced as well. And that's in verses 67 to 69. They will not leave. They will not go. They hear the words of eternal life. They believe and they embrace the Holy One of God. So after all that's gone on in these couple of days and in this long chapter, it finally ends with the false disciples exposed and they leave, the true disciples revealed and they stay. In the process of this, I've been showing you the pathology of false disciples because you can see the characteristics of these false disciples being manifest all the way through the events in these few days. What have I told you going back to many weeks ago? False disciples are attracted by the crowd. We saw that in the opening two verses. They're attracted by the crowd. They're not drawn for intellectual reasons or even spiritual reasons necessarily. They're attracted by the crowd. That still works in religion. Secondly, false disciples are fascinated by the prospect of the supernatural. If you promise people something supernatural, even if you can't deliver it, you'll draw a crowd. Then Jesus could deliver on the supernatural. False disciples are fascinated by the prospect of the supernatural. We saw thirdly, when they wanted to make Jesus a king after he'd created food for them, They give evidence of being false disciples who are focused only on earthly benefits, only on earthly benefits. They were concerned about the food that perishes, Jesus said. Fourthly, we saw that unlike the disciples who saw Jesus walking on the water and confessed Him as Son of God and worshiped Him, the false disciples are not interested in worship. They're not interested in worship. And as I tried to point out to you, they like music and light shows and entertainment, but they're not really interested in worship. We saw, fifthly, in verses 22 to 27, false disciples seek personal satisfaction. They seek personal satisfaction. They showed up the next day, and they wanted their needs met, the day after He had fed them the night before. Fifthly, false disciples make demands on God. They think of God as some kind of a repository, some kind of a bank, some kind of a genie who can deliver to them what they want. We saw that in the demands they made on Jesus in verses 28 to 34. And then finally, last time, and this was such an important point, false disciples are not satisfied with Christ. They're not satisfied with Christ. We looked at that in verses 35 to 41. They're not satisfied with Him. They want what He gives. They don't want Him. He kept saying, I'm going to give you the bread. I am the bread. I am the bread. I am the bread. You must receive Me, without any promise of any earthly prosperity whatsoever. So just quickly summarizing, false disciples attracted by the crowd, fascinated by the supernatural, focused on earthly benefits, not interested in true worship, seeking personal satisfaction, making demands on the Lord, not satisfied with a relationship with Him, but wanting what He could give, are still around when we come to verse 41. And this is the eighth characteristic. They do not understand divine revelation. They do not understand divine revelation. We already know that. We already know that. When He started talking to them about bread, about being the bread of life, verse 32 is where He began that. He said, I am the bread of life. I am the bread that's come down from heaven. I am the bread that is the bread of God. God has sent me. He talks about His pre-existence, talks about His purpose for coming, talks about the promise that He brings, which is eternal life. I was in heaven with God. God has sent me to be the soul-satisfying bread and to provide eternal life. That's the theme starting in verse 32, and we've looked at it, so we won't go back through all of it. They don't get it. They don't understand it. It doesn't fit into their minds. So verse 41, the Jews are grumbling, saying, He said, I'm the bread that came down out of heaven. They were saying, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does He now say, I've come down out of heaven? This is like a joke. This is mockery. They can't grasp truth. Let me tell you something about false disciples. They never understand divine revelation. They're always on the outside. And because they don't understand it, there is a general indifference to it. There may be some feigned interest in it. That is why false teachers don't have to feed people a true representation of the Word of God. They don't have to give people the Word of God, a true understanding, because people who are false disciples don't have any capacity to grasp the Word of God. They have no real hunger for it. In fact, look over just for a minute at John chapter 8, and I can illustrate that. Look at verse 42. Jesus said to them, if God were your Father, you'd love Me. If God were your Father, they were saying, God, of course, is their Father, these Jewish leaders. If God were your Father, you would love Me, for I proceeded forth and have come from God. For I have not even come on My own initiative, but He sent Me. Then He says this, why do you not understand what I'm saying? It is because you cannot hear My word. You can't understand it. You don't because you can't. This is not just unwillingness. This is inability. Why can't you? Because it's a foreign language. You come from a different strain. You come from a different family. You, verse 44, are of your father, the devil. And you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning, doesn't stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks, it's a lie. He speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Let me put it simply. False disciples are very comfortable with lies. Very comfortable with lies. You wonder why so many people follow false teachers. The reason is that's their family. They live in a world of lies. They are the children of Satan. Their father is the devil. False disciples cannot understand divine revelation. They don't get it. Verse 45, because I speak the truth, you do not believe me. Verse 47, he who is of God hears the words of God. For this reason, you do not hear them because you're not of God. It's that simple. If you belong to God, you believe in God, you're part of His family, you hear His word. You want to hear it, you long for it, you embrace it, you understand it. If you're a false disciple, you don't understand it. You would just as soon hear something else that tickles your ears. It's an inability, it's an incapacity. Because your nature has placed you in an alien family. Look at chapter 10 for a moment. Chapter 10 in John's Gospel, where Jesus essentially says the same thing, again, talking to the Jewish leaders and the people who would also be gathered around with them. They say to him in verse 24, how long will you keep us in suspense if you're the Christ? Tell us plainly, which of course he's done many times. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. And the works that I do in my Father's name, those testify of me. So you have the evidence from my words, you have the evidence from my works. Verse 26, you do not believe because you are not of my family. You're alien. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, they follow me, I give eternal life to them, they will never perish, no one will snatch them out of my hand. This is the case with false disciples. They can't understand the truth. Now go back to John 6. So how do they respond? And by the way, we've gone through this message. We did it the Sunday before Christmas in more detail. If we pick it up at verse 41, the Jews are grumbling about him because of what he said in verses 32 to 40 about the bread of life, the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger. Who believes in me will never thirst. Whoever believes in me will have eternal life. I will raise him up at the last day. He's talking in metaphoric terms about himself being the only provision for the soul, the only one who can provide eternal life, and he provides it to those who believe in him, and he will hold them and raise them all at the last day. And what is their response? Verse 41, these are the elite teachers of Israel. They were grumbling about him. They were grumbling about him because he said, I am the bread that came down out of heaven. They were saying, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I've come down out of heaven? They don't get it. It doesn't register. They're beyond the possibility of being reached and affected. Jesus doesn't argue with them. He doesn't argue with them at all. He simply says to them, don't grumble among yourselves. Stop. Stop this. And then he has to rest again in verse 44 on the truth that no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. Finds his comfort in the doctrine of divine sovereignty. They don't understand the truth. On the other hand, pick it up at verse 45. Anybody who does understand the truth has been taught by God. As it is written in the prophets, and he quotes Isaiah, and they shall all be taught of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. The only way that you can ever come to believe in Jesus Christ is when the Father God begins to teach you, when the Father takes the Word and by the Spirit instructs your soul and your mind. It's not, verse 46, that you go to heaven and meet God and have a private tutorial. No, God will instruct you through the one who is from God, the only one who's seen the Father, even the Lord Jesus Christ. When you come to Christ and see Christ and meet Christ and hear the message of Christ and believe in Christ and have eternal life, you give evidence that the Father has done His work in your mind and heart. So, false disciples do not get it. They do not understand divine truth. Anyone who does understand divine truth understands it because the Father has chosen them, the Father has drawn them, the Father has taught them, and the Father has given them to Christ. Still, He reminds them that there is eternal life to any who believe. Verse 47, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life." I am, verse 51, "the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever." Even though he understands the sovereignty of God, he also understands the volition of man. So, just to reinforce that eighth point in our little outline, false disciples cannot understand divine revelation unless the Father instructs them, unless they are transferred from being under the domain of Satan in the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son by a divine miracle of regeneration. Otherwise, they can't hear His Word. And as I told you last time, they're easily led by false teachers. In fact, they're in a world of false teachers. False disciples are happy to live in a world of false teachers. Where you find false teachers who are successful, they're successful because they have false disciples following them. And this is obvious from verse 61. Jesus, conscious that His disciples grumbled. Where did they pick that up? Well, back in verse 41, it was the Jewish leaders who were grumbling, criticizing, mocking. Now, these disciples are grumbling. What does this tell us? This tells us that where you have false disciples who are about to defect anyway, you have very strong influence from false teachers. The false leaders of Israel were grumbling about Jesus, and the false disciples picked up on that. First they grumbled, and then they stumbled. "Does this cause you to stumble?" He says. "Does this cause you to stumble?" Well, it did. In fact, Paul in 1 Corinthians 1 says, "The cross and the preaching of the gospel was a stumbling block to the Jews." So here are false disciples who grumble and stumble over the truth. Grumble and stumble over the truth, because they can't understand the truth. And so they're happy to be influenced by false teachers who abound in an arena where false disciples are arrayed. You always find the two together. All right, that takes me to one final point, just briefly. False disciples have no interest in embracing the cross. False disciples have no interest in embracing the cross. Go to the end of verse 51. He says, "The bread also which I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." This is new. This is new. He has said, "I am the bread of life. You have to believe in me. I am the bread of life. You have to believe in me." Clearly, the bread is a metaphor because its counterpart is believing. I am the bread. You must believe in me. In fact, he even says in verse 50, "You must eat," carrying out that metaphor. Says it again in 51, "Anyone who eats will live." But now he adds another dimension. the bread which I will give for the life of the world, not just me, not only you have to accept me, receive me, but end of verse 51, the bread also which I will give for the life of the world is my flesh, my flesh, my body. This is a reference to his death, his sin offering, his sacrifice on the cross. I will give my flesh for the life of the world. What does it mean of the world? Does it mean the whole world is going to be saved to the death of Christ? No. What it does mean is the world only has one Savior. He says, I will give for the life of the world my flesh. This is the only offering in the world that can bring salvation. The world has no other provision for eternal life. There's no salvation in any other name than Jesus Christ. I will give my flesh for the life of the world. And you must eat my flesh. And I stop here and say the terrible corrupted aberration of the Roman Catholic Mass gets inserted here. This is where the Roman Catholic system devised the Mass, which is a corrupt notion that somehow the priest can turn the juice into the actual blood of Christ and the bread into the actual body of Christ, re-sacrifice Christ, and people literally eat what is essentially literally his blood and body. That is a horrible travesty on the one offering that Christ made, never to be made again. It also is a travesty against his ascension, because when he ascended fully as he was. There are many other elements. But the twisting of this is where that came from. But let's understand what it really meant. What, if you said to somebody, I have something I need to tell you. It's really important for your life. And I know it's not going to be easy, but you're going to have to swallow this if you want to get to the next level. Do you understand that? You understand that I'm not asking you to eat something literally, right? If you can't swallow this, you're never going to get to the next level. That's simply a metaphoric way of saying you have to embrace this. You have to acknowledge this. And that's what he's saying here. It isn't just that you have to accept me as the pre-existent bread that came down from heaven. Accept me as the provision of the Father by His will. Accept me as the only one who can supply eternal life. But you have to eat my flesh. That is to say, you have to be able to accept my death. And this was a horrible thing for the Jews and why the gospel was such a stumbling block. Because they had no room for a crucified Messiah. That is why on the road to Emmaus in Luke 24, verses 25 and following, Jesus says to the disciples from the Old Testament, here in the Old Testament, let me show you why it was necessary for the Messiah to suffer and die. This is a simple metaphor. You have to be able to accept my death. And he piles it on without really advancing the statement. He just repeats it. The Jews began to argue with one another. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Again, more mockery. So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man, and I'll add this, drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves. They must have shrunk back in horror because obviously Leviticus 17 forbids drinking of animal blood, let alone human blood. Nobody would do that, not cannibals. But they knew. They knew he was speaking metaphorically. Rabbis talk like that all the time. You've got to be willing to accept the sacrifice of my flesh and the shedding of my blood to embrace the cross. This is so shocking to them that he says it again, verse 54, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I'll raise him up on the last day to eternal life, obviously. Says it again in verse 55, my flesh is true food, my blood is true drink. Verse 56, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him, comes into union with me. In order to come into union with Christ, you have to accept His atoning death. You have to accept that He offered His body a sacrifice for sin and shed His blood as the one who was executed in our place. Verse 57, as the living Father sent me back to His preexistence, and I live because of the Father, back to the Father's will, he who eats me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down out of heaven, not as the fathers ate and died in the bread that Moses provided in the wilderness. He who eats this bread will live forever. I mean, the bottom line here is false disciples have no real interest in embracing the cross. Oh, they may want to wear a cross on their t-shirt, but a false disciple doesn't embrace the fullness of the gospel, of the atoning work of Jesus Christ, accepting fully the reality of the atonement. That is the point. And the evidence here is clear. Some of the disciples said, this is pretty hard stuff to listen to, verse 60. Then they grumbled, then they stumbled, and verse 66, they left. They left. Why is the false disciple so disinterested in the atonement? Because the false disciple is not hungry for righteousness. The false disciple is not hungry for holiness. The false disciple is not hungry for forgiveness. The false disciple is not being slaughtered in his or her conscience. The false disciple is not feeling the fury and the weight of divine judgment hanging over his head. The false disciple has all the answers. The false disciple is satisfied with whatever the world can give. The false disciple wants his own will fulfilled. Jesus said He didn't come to call the righteous. Why? They don't come. They're not hungry and thirsty for righteousness because they think they have it. But once a person is broken over his sinfulness, shattered when awakened to his lost condition and its eternal consequences, once a person sees the void, the gnawing emptiness of his soul, the hunger for holiness begins to rise, the desire to be clean, the longing for peace and joy and love and hope and escape from everlasting punishment in hell, then that person will come and eat. You know, Christ may be presented to people in all His heavenly glory. They may respect His person. They may admire His beauty. They may be touched by His love and kindness. They may be awed by His power. They may even shed a few tears over the way He was mistreated. But it is only when they see Him as the only hope for their forgiveness by the sacrifice of Himself on the cross that they will come to Him. False disciples, they don't come on those terms. True disciples do. Peter spoke for them, "To whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and have come to know. You're the Holy One of God." Look, many are interested, drawn by the crowd, fascinated by the supernatural, desirous of earthly things, indifferent toward real worship, they like to be entertained, seeking only personal satisfaction, want a God who will meet their demands, have no desire for a real relationship with Him, no understanding of His truth, His Word, and no true hunger for the repentance and the righteousness that comes through the recognition of sin and the glory of the cross. And the question at the end is, what kind of disciple are you? And that's the right question as we come to the Lord's table. Let's bow in prayer. Father, we've laid it open for our own minds and hearts to understand, and yet we still are dependent upon You being the teacher. For anyone who comes to You comes because You have taught him. So Lord God, take this truth and be the teacher. As we come to this table, may we now take this cup and bread, and for what they really are, just symbols to help us remember that Jesus gave His flesh and His blood to die our death in our place.